am happy and blessed. Well, I am thankful to be here today, thankful to be saved and born again in the blood of Christ, thankful to know my Lord and Savior today, that no matter what happens in this world, no matter what tragedy falls, no matter what problem that may occur today, I know the Lord Jesus Christ is with me. And you know what? He's with us in the happy times. He's with us in the bright times. He's with us in the mountaintop experience. And he's with us in the valley. He's with us in the dark times. And I want us all to know that today so that we may have our gratitude toward the one that is in heaven for who not only saved our soul, but you know what? He's given us life here on earth. Amen. I'm thankful for that today. I mean, I don't know how many times I've said it. I'm 43 years old. Never in my life thought that I would live to see 43. Never in my life thought that I would live to see that. And I'll tell you, after I got saved, I was born again in the blood of Christ, and after I was called to preach and became a student of the Word, I was shocked that I would ever see 30, because I thought the Lord was going to come back here that quick. And then I was shocked that when I saw 40, because I still thought the Lord was coming back. And friend, I'm going to tell you, I live my life with the fact that I want to be surprised at the next moment comes. You say, why do you live that way? It's not a fear of dying. It's not a fear of death by any stretch of the imagination. We are to be looking for that blessed hope. We are to be looking for, expecting him to come. It's called the intimacy of Christ. His intimate return is right there. And guys, it may be 30 years. It may be 20 years. It may be 50 years. It may be 5 days, 5 minutes, 5 seconds. We have to live our life as if this is our last day, as if there is no tomorrow. I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles up to the New Testament, into the first epistle of John this morning. First epistle of John, and I know I've asked you to stand quite a few times today already, but I'm going to ask you one more time, if you're willing and if you're able to this morning. We're going to stand when you get to 1 John and chapter 4. I want to bring a message that God knows my heart. God knows the direction that I want to go, and he knows my desire today. And yes, I have an outline, and yes, I have my notes down, but I ask God before the service back there in the little vestry room, little prayer room, vestry room, treasury room, whatever that little room is called between the gents in the hallway. I ask God, if we need to go off outline, take the outline, throw it in the rubbish bin, take the lead today. Anoint us as you will with thy Holy Spirit. John, 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, if you will. Let's stand as we honor the reading of the Word of God. We'll pray, and then we'll have a seat for a spell for the sermon this morning. The fourth chapter of the first epistle of John, in the fourth verse, this is the encouraging verse that we receive. The Bible says, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Father in heaven, I pray today again that you would place thy special blessings upon the Word of God this morning. Lord, I pray that you would take the reins, take the helm, visit us, dear God, with the Holy Spirit this morning. We pray that you would lead, God, and direct us in every step of the way, every word that we say. Dear God, every thought that we may have in our life today, in our hearts, whatever intentions they may be, please bring them under the submission, dear God, I ask, to you and thy word this morning. Father, we lift up thy precious name. We love you. We give you glory, honor, and praise. And we thank you, Father, from the depths of our heart. We thank you for eternal salvation. We thank you for the three new souls, dear God, that have been a profession of faith as Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And Father, we pray, knowing that there are those right now, right on the brink of making that decision, even yet here, dear God, in this building, just behind us, Father, I pray the Holy Spirit of God intervene, and I ask you to save eternally that soul. Father, touch them, we ask, dear God, that complete another faithful, full forgiveness may be made, that they may be securely and surely saved by the blood of thy precious Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, in whom we ask all of these things today. Amen and amen. Thank you so much, and please be seated. I do believe the Lord is working in a mighty way in all of our lives. I believe that the Lord works in a mighty way in all of our lives every single day. Even when we get in the midst of lives that seemingly are mundane or seemingly are ritualistic or seemingly kind of like a rut. You know, we get up in the morning, we pray, we read our Bible, we have our coffee, we eat our breakfast, we go to work, and then we come home and we have our dinner and our tea, and then we have our fellowship and our time, and maybe we read a little bit longer, or maybe we turn the telly on, or whatever you do on your day. I know there's times that it seems like their life is just ritualistic, like it's just a continual process of the same thing every single day. And for the most part, guys, that's what our life is. Our life is a continual process of repeat events in the days that the Lord has given us. And that's not a bad thing, because God has given us a sphere of influence to live in, to continue a repetitive life that we may bring glory and honor unto Him, so that the world may see consistency in our life. Amen. It's not a bad thing that your life is scheduled out for 5 days, and you know that you got to be at work from 8 o'clock to 5 o'clock, and eat lunch at 12, eat breakfast at 6, and read your Bible at 6:30. I mean, that's not a bad thing. Amen. Personally, I like schedules. I like to look at a piece of paper and know where I'm going to be the next, if it was up to me, the next 120 days, who knows? But I mean, that's impossible, I understand. But I like to book things out. I have a big calendar. I keep things on my phone. I enjoy having a life that is scheduled, but also with the cushion just in case something comes in. There's nothing wrong with a scheduled life, but sometimes that scheduled life becomes almost an albatross in our mind. It becomes a weight so heavy, so, again, I used the word mundane a second ago, and we interpret it being mundane, but our life is not mundane. Our life is a life that is lived through the eyes of the Lord Jesus Christ, through the representation of Him in this world, and it's far from mundane, because the people of this world are watching you, they're looking at you, they're looking to see what you're doing in this life, and sometimes the best that you can do is just throw the reins down, say, God, take the reins, direct me into the way that you would have me to go, because I just cannot do it on my own. And guys, that is the reality of the Christian life. We are faced with many trials in our life, trials that seemingly come from all angles sometimes. There are days when the sun is shining so bright. Yesterday was so beautiful. If my calculations are right, which they're probably not, but if they are, it got up to 76 degrees Fahrenheit yesterday, somewhere, okay? In England, not here. I don't know. I don't know what it was here. We ran up to Leeds yesterday. And I'm going to tell you, we drove, but nevertheless, we went up to Leeds yesterday. And it was so beautiful. It was a beautiful ride home, and I felt so much better when I got back in Wales, amen. But anyway, just kidding. Nevertheless, I got back in. The weather was just, it was beautiful all day long, from start to finish, gorgeous weather. And there's days spiritually that are like that in our lives. No matter what's going on outside, whether it's rain, snow, sleet, tornadoes, hurricanes, there are days when the sunshine of God shines down into our heart that it seems like everything is brighter, everything is illuminated, everything is just beautiful. And then there's the other days. There's the other days that seemingly we struggle in life. That it seems like problems and struggles are facing us from every single angle. Some of the problems that we face in the life in this world today, they're self-inflicted, meaning that we simply bring them on ourselves, and that we just don't obey the word of God, or we don't do right, or we just do something wrong. Whatever. There are issues in our life that are self-inflicted. Some are just single events, meaning they come and go just as quick as they came in. They fleet out just as fast. But at the end of the day, if you're here this morning and you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you're sitting here today born again of the precious blood of Christ, you have overcome the world. And every single event and every single trial and every single tribulation and every single trouble that this world may throw at us today, that this system is set to destroy the creation of God, to glorify, that is built to glorify Him, as we all are to do and say, you have overcome that world. It does not matter what happens outside these doors if you are saved and born again today. You are an overcomer. But can I say this to you this morning? We are often tempted to quit. I don't know of any child of God today that would be honest before God Himself that's never been tempted to give up. That's never been tempted just to throw up, throw in the white towel. To forsake it all and just say, my soul, I can't do it any longer. We're going to have smaller trials in our life. Guys, we're going to have struggles with things that you and I may look at as being simple. Like attending church. We're going to struggle with that, aren't we? Everybody that's born again in the blood of Christ have struggled with church attendance sometime in their life. That's just the way it is. You may be sitting here today going, oh man, I tell you what, I feel so guilty and so bad because I'm a born again believer in Christ and because I struggled back in the day of attending church. Listen, that's normal and that's natural because you're still fighting the flesh. It's part of it. I'm not saying this to be a continual thing, but I am telling you that we're going to have these small trials. The world will bring events. It'll bring things into our life to distract us away from the house of God. But guys, listen, don't get so caught up and say, well, I'm just going to quit if I can't be committed all the time. Don't do that because God is still on your side. He's still giving you the power to overcome whatever this world may throw your way. My friend, there are battles out there. Trials that we are faced in this world today. There are struggles that you and I face in this world today. There's things that we face here in the United Kingdom, that we face here in Wales, and we face here in the Kennet Valley. There are things that we are going to face on a daily basis that when we look at them and we evaluate our life, they're first world problems. First world problems. You know, like getting upset because you don't have cell service. Amen? I battled it for, 5 months, 6 months here? Turned off, no data, this data, that. I mean, it was a mess. At the end of the day, that's a first world problem. I mean, you know, like the internet going out, or the power going out, or, you know, hey, what something went out last week in our house. I can't remember what it was. Oh, the washer went out. The breaker popped in the morning, ended up being the washer bad. So the washer was out. We can't wash our clothes. We hand washed for a day or two. That didn't work out that well, but we did do it, amen. I tell you, it's hard to get the soap out of those things, amen? But nevertheless, you know, here, those are first world problems, guys. But how many times have we been faced, listen carefully, with first world problems? And we say, man, I'm just going to quit. I'm just going to throw in the towel. I just can't do this anymore. 1 John 4:4 says, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Can I tell you that as a promise from God Himself? No matter how strong, no matter how mighty, no matter how many, no matter what the multitude may be, no matter if they seem like they are the majority, and in a great way they are, it does not matter. This world, my friend, listen, we have overcome the world because greater is the God that is inside of us than the God of this world. Never let your heart fail from that truth right there. Because if you don't, you're going to quit. I want to encourage you today not to quit. I want to encourage you this morning to don't quit in the midst of struggles. Don't quit in the midst of dark days. Don't quit in the midst of tribulations. Don't quit in the midst of trials. Don't quit, my friend, when the chips may not fall like you think they should. Number one, I want to share with you this morning, if you go to 1 John chapter 4, and in verse 5, that we will have battles in this life. On the heels of reading verse 4, giving us the encouragement that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world, verse 5 tells us that this is the reference to the word they from verse 4, they are of the world. If you go back to verse 4 and in relation to verse 5, when it says, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Thee and them from verse 4 tied directly into they of verse 5. They, meaning them. They, the world. They are of the world. Therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. We sit back and we wonder today why we don't have a voice in the world today, a voice in Wales today, a voice in England today, a voice in Ireland, a voice in Northern Ireland, a voice in Scotland, a voice in America. We don't have a voice today because the world is going to listen to itself, and it's not going to listen to us unless the Spirit of God Himself intervene into their heart and change their heart from the inside out. We can try reformation all we want. External reformation does not work. Internal repentance and a turn toward the Lord Jesus Christ is the only thing that shall make a difference in this world today. When souls get saved down Lewis and down Badeau and down Davis Street, down Cardiff Road, when you begin to see souls get saved and families put back together and lives change, that's when you're going to see a change in this community. That's when we're going to see the pubs close down and the bedding places close down. And that's when we're going to see the difference in people's lives. And that's when you're going to stop hearing so much profanity in the road. My soul, I tell you, I get so tired of hearing people cuss. Amen. I'm going to tell you, I heard a quote the other day that cursing is nothing more than an idiot trying to explain himself or express himself. And that is true. Amen. A gentleman saved or lost does not use profanity. Amen, preacher. Oh, it crawls all over me. My dad taught me that profanity is nothing more than the use of someone who has the lack of vocabulary. Go back to the days in your life before you were saved. And some of us were too young to really understand that when you got saved. And that's a huge blessing. Can I say that if you were here today and you got saved in an early age? Don't you dare let the testimonies of those who got saved later on in life overshadow the testimony that you have. Hallelujah, man. I would rather myself to have that testimony that I got saved 5 years old and I lived a God-pleasing life all my life. Don't let it overshadow. God blesses both of them, it's true. But never let it overshadow the testimony that God has given you. The ways of this world will bring forth battles into our life, my friend. Battles that we faced back then when we were lost, but the world heard us then. And now being saved, child of God this morning, the world will bring battles into our lives sometimes on a daily basis, struggles into our life that we will all experience. Some struggles, listen carefully because this is the meat of where we're getting ready to go in the battles. Some struggles are individual. He brings battles into our life on an individual basis. But can I share this thought with you this morning that some battles that we will face in our life are collective battles? They're battles that all of us are facing. Not just us here at Sarah Chapel, not just those down the street at on Brawl Street, or not just those down on Davis Street, not just those over in the Rhondda Valley or up in Sir Howley or whatever. Hey, listen. They're battles that are collected for every one of us. Some of those battles come on a daily basis. Let me say this to you this morning. There are battles, my friend, of conditions. Battles of conditions. The news this weekend has been inundated by the events in America. Everybody knows it. Everybody hears it. It's all over Twitter. It's all over Instagram. I'm sure it's all over Facebook. It's all over emails. It's everywhere we know. We hear of what had happened in America. England and Wales legalized same-sex marriage back in 2013, and it came into force in May of 2014, with the first so-called marriage occurring on the 29th of May. Scotland passed the same law February 2014, and it took effect in December of the same year. Northern Ireland has no plans whatsoever to legalize the unions, but we will see how that goes. Last month, we found that the referendum was approved in Ireland, most of which the churches there were in utter dismay that it passed there. And just on the 26th of June, 2015, this past Friday, the United States of America Supreme Court, I'd like to call it the inferior court, but nevertheless, the Supreme Court approved a federal bill to recognize homosexual marriage in all 50 states. Friend, 30 years ago, we would have never believed that the end times media would be dominated by this issue. Much less our parents 50 years ago would not have thought that. And our grandparents 70 years ago would have not have thought that. But can I share this simple little thought with you today? We are in the end times. And the Bible does say that perilous times will come. And we are on the brink of a figurehead standing up and unifying the world for it with a pseudo-peace for 7 years that is broken in 3.5. He's called the Antichrist. Make no mistake and understand that the Word of God denotes the Antichrist in Daniel chapter 11, verse 37, saying, "Neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any God. He shall magnify himself above all." Now, he may be a eunuch, he may be a sodomite, he may be somebody that doesn't have time for any of it, but he's a person that comes in and says that he's God. And we know that. So there are battles that you and I face on a daily basis of conditions. Conditioned battles, like people battling the weather, struggling with the weather, too cold, too hot. These are the battles that we're facing in our world. And here's the deal. God knew when we were going to be born. He knew that I was going to be born in 1971. I know you thought anyone, but nevertheless, amen. He knew that Darius was going to be born in 2000. He knew Lorraine was going to be born in 1992. You know, he knew these things, amen. You always guess later or whatever, anyway. He knew these things. He appointed us to be here in this world at this time. And we cannot quit now. Amen. There's battles of conditions. There are battles of consequence, my friend. Beloved, the issue is bad enough in and of itself. I understand that. But guys, can you understand? It's not about marriage equality that we're seeing today. It's the redefinition or the redefining of marriage as a whole. But can I ask you a question this morning as we look at the battles of consequence? What should we expect? This may get touchy, it may be personal, I have no idea, but it's still the Bible. Hebrews 13, 4 says, "Marriage is honorable and all, and the bed undefiled, but whoremongers and adulterers God will judge." Our nations have dishonored marriage and the union that God has ordained for 30, 40, and 50 years. It's not something that just showed up in the 21st century. Divorce is an epidemic. In the United States of America, I know at least, is that 1 out of 2 marriages end in divorce. Shacking up together prior to marriage is commonplace. When somebody says, "This is my partner," they're not saying, "That's my wife back there, by the way. She's not my partner." Amen. "I didn't have a business agreement with her. She's my wife, praise God. I'm given over to her. I'm a sacrificial position. As Christ loved the church, I'm to love her and give myself to her." It's not an arrangement that we made. Let's live together for 5 or 6 years and see how it goes. But just because society has accepted such actions does not make the Bible antiquated or archaic. It doesn't make God's law of none effect. If it was wrong 100 years ago, if it was wrong 1,000 years ago, it was wrong 2,000 years ago, it's wrong in God's eyes today. No matter where we live or when we live, the Word of God is perfect then, just as it is perfect now. There are battles of consequence that we're facing in our nation today, and God knew that you and I were going to live here. Amen. He knew that we were going to be part of this generation. He didn't wake up one morning and go, "Wow, I can't believe it. That BJ is down there living in, man, I didn't see that coming." God didn't do that. He appointed us to live in a time where a nation is facing the battles of consequence, and we are in the midst of it, amen. You know what the temptation is? Friend, the temptation is to mistreat these people that have chosen this life. Now you're probably going to say, "Oh, preacher, you're going to go soft on us now." I'm not going soft on you. I'm going to stand on the same principle that I've always stood. Matter of fact, 11 years ago, I stood in my pulpit in Tennessee when Massachusetts became the first church to try to pass a bill on homosexual marriage. And it was passed, cut down, passed, cut down, passed, cut down. All of this has been going. This is nothing new. I preached for 1 hour and 15 or 1 hour and 20, the longest sermon I ever preached in my life. And I'm not trying to top it today. And the title of the message was "Marriage Bed Undefiled." You see, the tendency, my friend, is to go out and mistreat and browbeat the homosexuals. I believe it's a lifestyle choice. You're not born that way. You may be born with effeminate tendencies. That may be true. That's fine. I can accept that. But there are some people that are born with drunken tendencies. Some people are born with violent tendencies, and they give way to them. You say, well, preacher, how do you know that? Because I've dealt with them for 30-something years. I've been by the bedside of a 6'4", 88-pound man dying of AIDS. I've worked with them almost my entire life, and I've had compassion on them. Somebody asked me, preacher, how do you witness to a homosexual? I said, how do you witness to a Catholic? And they said, I said, same way. What are you going to do? You're going to go over there and you're going to browbeat them because of the sin they chose, but not browbeat the drunkard over here, the murderer, and all. No, sir, it doesn't work like that. We have to understand that the prevalence of the sinful lifestyle that we see, it's not a cause of our nationality or our nation's demise. It's not a cause of the collective downfall of our nation, both here in the United Kingdom and over in Ireland, as well in the United States. It's not the cause, my friends. But it's not the reason our countries are in demise. Now, we want to say that. We want to sit back and we want to point the finger at them. But reality, we need to point the finger at us. The downfall of our governments, the downfall of our countries, the downfall of families and churches is not being caused by homosexuality. It's not, homosexuality is not the reason. Listen carefully. It's the result. It's the curse that God brought on a nation when a nation turned its back against God. Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1 and in verse 21, the Bible says, because that when they knew God, that means they knew who He was, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful and became vain in their imagination, and their foolish heart was darkened, professed themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, and to the birds and the four-footed beasts and the creeping things. And I'll stop it right there. You know what happened? When they knew God as a nation, they said, nope, we're not going to glorify the God of heaven. We're going to glorify the God of the earth, the God of the world, and the God of the birds and the bees and the sycamore trees. And we're going to honor them up and above God Himself. Therefore, God darkened their heart. And the next verse says, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanliness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie and worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up unto vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. I could park there for just a little bit, but I won't. 1973, the United States of America. 60-some-odd million babies have been destroyed, been murdered in abortion. That is not natural. The Bible says, the Bible goes on to say in verse 27, and likewise also the men leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust toward one another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, receiving themselves that recompense of their error, which was me. Listen, I'm not, the message is not about the issue that is all the news. I'm not going to browbeat that. Salvation is what is needed. It's needed for the murderer. It's needed for the drunkard. It's needed for the drug addict. It's needed for the homosexual. It's needed for the clean person who's lived a perfect life, but not in Christ Jesus. Everybody needs salvation. And you can't look at one and need it more. Yes, somebody may be forgiven them more, but that's their personal responsibility with God. You can't say, well, I'm going to go reach them. The power of the gospel is brought into the lives of those that are deceived in this world today. And my friend, God chose us to live in this time, this dispensation, this age. So don't quit because of the battles of consequence. Don't quit because of the battles of condition. And friend, don't quit because of the battles of concern. How many times have we sought the Lord to answer a prayer? And it seems as if the prayers are not making it past the ceiling. Sometimes the Lord answers the prayers just as quick as we ask them. Oh, I love those days. Sometimes He doesn't. And I got a list of pages in my prayer journal. I'm waiting for them. There's a couple that I won't answer much quicker than the other ones, if you don't know the truth. But I got a list. The Apostle Paul suffered greatly in the ministry of spreading the gospel around this world. He mentions in the 11th chapter of 2 Corinthians, he mentions the persecutions, the beatings, the whippings, the shipwreck, the hungering, the thirsting, all the things, the multitude of perils that he faced, and on top of all that, the care of the churches. It's what God chose him to do. Beloved, there are battles that occur in our life of concern. If you take Paul again, he sought the Lord three times for that messenger of Satan that buffeted him to be removed from him. God said, my grace is sufficient for thee. You take Daniel. Daniel prayed for 3 weeks. The Bible says that he was in mourning. 21 days later, the angel shows up to answer that prayer. Daniel chapter 10. He says, I heard you the first day. He said, but, of course, he said the kings there, the kingdom, the kings of Persia, he referred to the real king of Persia, who's Satan. He said, they were fighting. One of the princes, Michael, that old archangel, he came down and he helped me, and I'm here today. Guys, there are prayers that are going up before God today that you are making, that you want to be answered right now, and God's going to answer them, but he's going to answer them in his time, because you've overcome the world, and it may be 21 days, it may be 21 months, it may be 21 minutes, it may be 21 seconds, but God is going to answer them. But we fight those battles of concern. We get so concerned. Is God hearing me? Yeah, he's hearing me. Battles today that we're going to face. And we must remember the forces that are behind the battles today. The Bible says that we wrestle not with flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. The battle is not with the person across the street. The battle is not with somebody who names another ruler. The battle is not somebody who's got their idea of marriage turned off. The battle is not with them. The battle is a spiritual battle that's beyond them. And if we can fight that battle through prayer and witness through the power of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to these souls, the victory can be theirs, just like it's ours. And future great king of Israel, as he stepped up to defeat Goliath. I mean, my goodness, it was a losing battle by all visible accounts, but he recognized who the battle was. He said, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you. He will give you into our hands. He knew victory would come. But he knew that there would be a victory, beloved. And I'm going to ask you this morning. Do you know there's a victory? Time has failed me this morning. And I'm not done with this, but I ask God to take control. Take me off outline. And that's what he's done. So I'm going to end with this thought. Yes, there's battles. And we're going to face these battles. There are battles of conditions of the world that we live in. But God was not shocked that you're alive in 2015 here in Aberaman. Didn't catch him off guard that you're here. It didn't catch him off guard that Supreme Court approved it. That it didn't catch him off guard last month in Ireland. Didn't catch him off guard last year in England and Scotland. Didn't catch him off guard, did it? It was going to happen. Knew you was going to be living here. Matter of fact, he knew this church was going to be here in November, amen? And knew you'd be sitting here today in June. That's my God. So yeah, there's battles out there. There's battles of condition. There's battles of consequence. That's the world we live in today. And there's battles of concern. And you may have prayers today that are just not being answered, but I'm going to ask you something. Have you lost the hope that God has given you? David didn't lose hope. He knew whose the battle was. It was the Lord's. David didn't lose faith. If he lost yours. Listen, he pressed forward. And my friend, we must not today lose hope. We must not this morning look at our world and say, I don't even recognize the world that I grew up in. Some for you, you may say that here today. You may say, South Wales is not what it was when I was a kid. I made a comment to my wife the other day. I think Andy David. I said, if the Lord tarries his coming, there's a good chance that one day we'll not even recognize the United States of America. This world's not my home, though. See, I'm a resident of a different place. You say you're an American. I'm a born-again believer. My residency is in heaven. And I'm not going to quit. Let me encourage you today. Yes, there are battles in this world. Yes, we're going to face them. And yes, God knew about them. So, beloved, don't quit. Press on and push forward. Keep hope, keep praying, and keep fighting the battles. Because with God, all things is possible. And the bottom line is this: greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. We bow your heads this morning. Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity that you've given us. We thank you for the liberty, Lord, that you've blessed us with. And Father, we thank you today for taking control. We submit unto you, Lord, the fruitfulness of the words that have proceeded today into the hearts and the ears and the minds of all present. I ask of you this morning, please touch and tender the hearts of each and every soul that will hear this message, be it online, be it here live today. Touch them, dear God, and take them and encourage them that no matter what is going on in the world today, they will not quit. Father, I thank you for not quitting on us. I praise the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for not coming down off the cross. I thank you, dear God in heaven, that the Lord Jesus Christ gave his life, yet 3 days later, he took it back himself, and he stepped out of that tomb. Lord, thank you for giving us the greatest example not to quit. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. Partaking of the Lord's table here tonight, and I asked the Lord this morning to give me the direction he got. He said he'd have me to go in for the sermon tonight, and I don't want it to ever sound as if the Lord, we could ever exhaust what the Lord has us to learn and on the Lord's table in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and we're going to get there here later on this evening. Obviously, we'll get there for the Lord's table, but to start out tonight, I do feel that the Lord has in store for us the sermon that we had started this morning. I believe God had us go directly where we went to this morning, and I believe he was finished with it when he was. And I feel it all in my heart that the Lord would have us to go back, return, and finish up the last 2 points of the message today, but obviously to start out with a brief review. So if you will, this evening, go ahead and open your Bibles up to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John in chapter 4. And when you get there, if you're able and willing to tonight, I'm going to ask you to stand as we honor the reading of the Word of God. 1 John in chapter 4 is where we will be. We've reached the message this morning on the topic of don't quit. The trials that we go through in our life, the battles that we face, the temptation just to throw in the towel, to just quit and say, I'm done, I'm finished, I'm not going to do that anymore, I'm not going to continue to serve the Lord anymore, I'm not going to do right anymore. That temptation is there, and I'll go ahead and tell you, my friend, it is always there, but I want to encourage every one of us this evening that we ought not quit. The reason we ought not quit is because of our text verse, our opening verse, 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, whereas the Bible tells us, if you will, ye are of God, little children, and I will overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Father in heaven, we thank you, dear God, for the opportunity to be here. We thank you, Lord, for the mighty blessings you've given each and every one of us. Lord, I thank you for all the souls that are here tonight. I thank you for the young people so desiring to come back to the house of God tonight. I pray that you bless them, Father. Make a difference in their lives, I pray, that you just touch them in a tremendous manner. Father, we thank you again for the safety that you've given us, Lord. We thank you for your perfect, preserved, pure Word of God that you've given us today. Let us adhere to it. Let us apply it into our hearts and our lives, that our actions may be seen and known to reflect our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in this earth. So, Father, without further ado, we ask you, dear God, to lay your mighty hands and your mighty touch upon your word this evening. And, Father, we just give you all the honor, glory, and praise for everything said, everything that is done, and all that would transpire from your spoken word tonight. In Christ's name we do ask. Amen and amen. Thank you so much, and please be seated. Made the reference this morning, I'll just review briefly tonight with each and every one of you. In verse 4, we read that you are of God, little children, and overcome them. That them is a reference that we find in the 5th verse there, saying they are of the world. The Bible says that we have overcome them because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. We find that the word them in verse 4 and the word world in verse 4, it works simultaneously with the verses in verse 5, but they, and of course the world there. And it speaks of they and them in verse 5 because we, as the children of God, as born again believers in Christ, as being solidified and sealed unto the day of redemption, we have overcome the world. No matter what happens in this life today, no matter what battles we may face, no matter the struggles, the tribulations, no matter the dark times, But God has given us a promise in the first epistle that John wrote in the fourth chapter in the fourth verse, that greater is he that is in you than he that is in this world. My friend, that's a promise that God has given us in his preserved word, but it is a promise, my friend, that Jesus Christ made long before over in Caesarea Philippi when he said, thou art Peter, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Amen. Those gates of hell is a picture of the world system and world religion. And this world religion and this world system will not prevail over the local church of our God tonight. We have that promise, my friend. We have that assurance, my friend, that God himself says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. We heard this morning, just on point number one, which had three subpoints, that there are battles that we are going to face in this world. We spun right off of verse 5 in that, where the Bible says, they are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. My friend, I do believe that worldly people speak of worldly things, and godly people speak of godly things. That doesn't mean that a godly person or a Christian or a saved individual can't speak about anything that's outside of the church. I wouldn't dare tell you that, amen. We can sit around and we can talk about, we can complain about motorcycles and their invisible imaginary lane that they have on the motorway. They make up their own lane. It's a figment of their imagination. It's there. It doesn't exist. It's not in the rule book, but you know, they think it does. Amen. I'm just picking a little bit from Brother Jason. Amen. There's an inside joke on that one. But we can talk about motorcycles and cars and hot rods and sports and crochet and dishcloths and washcloths, and there's nothing wrong with that. Amen. But the world is recognized by that which they speak, and they recognize one another. And there's battles that as a Christian that we will face. There are battles that we will experience. There's battles collectively and individually that you and I will face and are facing yet even now. Struggles from friends that will not understand why you act the way you do, because you're trying to live righteously and godly and in a clean manner in this present world. There are battles that we will face, battles of conditions that we spoke about this morning, just in the reigning things that will happen, the decisions that are made by the world, through the world, for the world, and all this and that. Those are things that God knew that we would be living right now in the conditions of this present world, amen. Battles that we would face. There's battles of consequence that you and I will experience in this life, in this world today. Now, we can't get away from it, but I will tell you this tonight. We need to understand that if it was right for God 1,000 years ago, if it was right with God 2,000 years ago, if it was right with God 6,000 years ago, it is right today in the eyes of God. God doesn't change, amen. He says, I am the Lord and I change not. Therefore, if he doesn't change, his righteousness doesn't change. And if his righteousness doesn't change, listen carefully, what he calls and deems wrong does not change either, amen. So there are battles of consequence that we will experience. And lastly, on that third subpoint before we go into tonight's message, there were battles of concern, beloved. And this is really what I want you to understand tonight in a great capacity. Some of you are here tonight and you've undoubtedly had a multitude of prayers for a long time. There's probably an individual that you've been praying for to be saved and born again that maybe you prayed for years, and you've lived a godly life before them, and you've lived it out before them, and you've given them the gospel tracts, and you've given them the Bible verses, and you've read the Word of God, and you've prayed that God may enrich and touch their lives and convict their soul, that they may come to the knowledge of the truth of the Word of God and be saved and gloriously born again. And I want to encourage you this tonight. Yes, there's a battle of concern. Understand, this battle is not ours. Just as David got ready to fight the foe of Goliath, he said, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. My friend, Daniel prayed for 21 days. Prayed for a prayer to be answered for 21 days. And it's recorded in Daniel chapter 10. We find this, that when that angel showed up to answer that prayer, he said, I heard you the first day. I heard you the first day. So my friend, I want to encourage us tonight as we go into point number two, point number one for this evening, is that yes, there's going to be battles that we're going to face. Yes, there's going to be battles that we're going to experience. Yes, there is, but greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And we must walk away. We must stand up. We must understand that we must not quit in this world today. We mustn't lose hope, but trust the Lord hears our prayers and sees our heart. We must tonight believe that as the children of God, we have and are the Lord's benefit. Look in verse 6 with me. We have and we are the Lord's benefit in our life. Verse 6 tells us that we are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth us not. Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Friend, there is a benefit of being the Lord's people. There is a benefit not only eternally that you are saved and born again by the blood of Christ and you're saved eternally, that if your life should end in this world tonight, being the children of God and being a child of God, you are born again, you're ushered into heaven. I was speaking to Brother Ken this morning, and he said that people tell him when he gets on that plane, they said, aren't you nervous about it crashing? He said, absolutely not. I get to go home if it crashes, amen. And that's exactly the way we must look at it. If a plane goes down, we're not worried about that because we're just going to be up in heaven just a little bit quicker than you are, amen and amen. And so we'll see you here, there, or may see you in the air. It doesn't matter, but I'm telling you, there's a benefit as being the Lord's people. There's a great thing that we have, a great benefit in being Christians tonight, born again believers in Christ. And I think we ought not ever forget that. I think we have a tendency to forget the benefit of being a child of God, because we look at it through the eternal eyes. And again, I'm not faulting you on that. I'm not faulting even myself on that. We have a tendency to look so much on the eternal, through the eternal eyes, that we lose the benefit that God has given us down here. In the midst of the battles on this earth, on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, on a yearly basis, God's hand is still upon us, amen. There's a benefit there. There's a recognizable difference between the people of God and those that are not. The Lord hears our prayers. We understand that. He sees our heart. He knows our struggles. He doesn't leave us alone. And the temptation in this world, when things get hard, things get tight, and things get tough, and there's problems in our life, that we just want to throw the towel in and quit. And I just want to say, don't quit in the midst of the battles, because we have the benefit tonight. We must stand, we must pray, we must stand, we must pray, and we must move forward in the eyes of God. We have the God of heaven and the God of earth on our side. And better yet, we not only have him on our side, but we're on his side. He hears the voice of those that know him, and he knows our need, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. I want to share a verse with you tonight. We're going to dissect it just briefly here this evening. And let me say at the forefront, I understand that doctrinally this verse is applied to Israel, and it is a physical application, but I believe there's a practical and spiritual application that you and I can thus apply in our lives to the children of God. Read with me from up top here, 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. Whereas the Bible says, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. The very first word that I want you to pay close attention to is the opening word of the verse that simply says if. This is the leading word that establishes the conditions for the Lord's blessings in our life, for the benefits that God has given us to bring into our life. That's what this word is, if. He moves on and says, if my people which are called by my name. Now, that's where a lot of people say, well, let me stop there, because that's directly only for Israel. This is what Peter said in his first epistle, chapter 2, verse 9. He says, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, an holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now what? Read those next ones with me. But are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Do you understand tonight that we, as common Gentiles in this world, there was a time in the history of our ancestors that we were not even a recognized people? As a matter of fact, the Jews looked at us as being nothing more than dogs. We were part of the other nations, otherwise in the Old Testament known as heathens. The word heathen translates other nations, meaning anyone outside of the nation of Israel. So when we look at that, we didn't have, no pun intended, a dog's chance of salvation outside of being able to proselyte into Judaism, which was more difficult than it sounds. But the Lord Jesus Christ came, died on the cross of Calvary, paid for my sins personally. Paid for your sins personally. And if you would have been the only one that needed their sins paid for, He would have still came down, lived 33 and one half sinless perfect years on this earth, been willing to suffer the shame, a despising death on the cross, be separated from the Father for the only time in eternal history, for 3 hours, be buried in the grave, go to the heart of the earth, and 3 days later take his own life up, raised from the grave, and ascend on high. If it was just you, he would have done the same thing. The Bible says that God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, Romans 5:8. You see, my friend, I understand the doctrinal applications of 2 Chronicles 7. I understand that. But there is a practical application, whereas the Bible has told us clearly that now we are called the people of God. So, if we are called the people of God, as a child of God, being born again of the blood of Christ, what condition must be met? Number one, we must do what? We must, as his people that are called by his name, we must establish the fact that we are a chosen generation. And first, we must humble ourselves. It says, shall humble themselves. The word humble means meek, submissive, or modest. The Bible says in 1 Peter 5:6, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you. Watch this. In due time. Now, whose time is that? That's not our time. That's his time. His due time. To humble yourself before him is to be willing to wait, to be patient, to be modest in your mindset, to be meek in your understanding, to be submissive to his will, and wait for him to exalt you in his time appointed. Not only did he say, not only is the condition of humbling ourselves in order to reap the benefits that God has given us in this life right now, but also a time of prayer. He says, and pray. Beloved, there is nothing that lies outside the reach of prayer except that which lies outside the will of God. If it is not God's will, you can pray for it, you can pray for it, and you can pray for it, and hope and pray that God doesn't give you anything outside of his will. But I'm going to tell you right now, prayer is the line that goes directly before the throne of heaven, and it is that line, my friend, that will bring what God wants in your life to benefit him and his glory. He said, shall humble themselves and pray. Watch this. Here's another connection. And seek my face. Do you know what Isaiah penned? Isaiah penned by inspiration of God in chapter 55 and verse 6. He says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. There's another verse that tells us that to draw nigh to God, and guess what? What will he do? Draw nigh to you. Now I want you to think about that term for just a second. We have no control over God. We can't control him. We can't make him do anything he doesn't want to do. Amen to that. But the Bible does say, to draw nigh to him, and guess what happens? He draws nigh to you. Now, I don't know about you, but there's a sweet touch, I believe, right there, that if we would just seek the face of God, if we would call upon him, if we would seek him while he may be found, if we would call upon him while he is near, if we would draw nigh to God in our heart, in our minds, in our souls, if we would just search him out, if we would just look for him upon our knees, and it's where we should do these things, searching for the Lord God so that we could get so close to him, there would be no doubt, no mistake in his will in our life. We're told to humble ourselves. We're told to pray. We're told to seek his face. We're also told to turn from their wicked ways. Beloved, this is a call of repentance. Bible tells me the him that knoweth to do good and doeth not, to him it is sin. He that knoweth to do good and doeth not, to him it is sin. There's a right thing that we should do. There's wrong things that we ought not do. But my friend, if we know the right thing to do, we do it not. It's just as wrong as going out there and doing the wrong thing. The sins of omission, just as guilty as the sins of commission. God has given us a formula here. He's given us a condition here. He said that if my people, that's us, children of God, born again believers in Christ, shall humble themselves and pray and seek his face and turn from our wicked ways, then here's the answer. Then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. Can I ask you a question tonight? Does our lands plural, need healing tonight. Yes, it does. My soul, we have families, we have friends, we have homes, we have lives, we have businesses, we have churches for all that matter. Needs to be healed tonight. And God has given us a formula tonight to reap His benefits in this world, to keep us to where we will not quit, that we can continue to move on, we can continue to move forward, that we can stand upon the precepts of the Word of God, that we can kneel in our hearts and our minds and our souls and bow before the throne of grace, that we can come boldly to the throne of grace, having confidence that He will answer our prayers and hear our prayers. But my friend, there is a formula. We must humble ourselves, we must pray, we must seek His face, and my friend, we must turn from the wicked ways, and God from heaven will reach down and heal our lands. Now you may be sitting there tonight and you're saying, yeah, well, it's perilous times and they've come. Yes, they are. There's perilous times. You may say, preacher, it's the end times and God's done. God's not finished till God says He's finished. If He's still sitting on the throne tonight, He's still wanting to see souls saved. He wants these streets here saved and born again. I said that this morning. If people will just get saved, if we'll just exalt Christ, if we'll lift up the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and get away from all of the other things. There's issues. My friend, listen, you can't please everybody. I'm not going to try to please everyone. I'm going to try to please God. I'm going to preach the word that He's given me. And here's the deal. If your beliefs do not line up with this word of God, I'm not changing the word to meet your beliefs. Amen. I want to see things change in this world. I want to see our land healed in this world. He said the promise that He'll hear from heaven, He'll forgive our sins, and He'll heal the land. And we need a healing today. We need a healing tonight. I understand the verse is directed doctrinally to Israel, but practically speaking, spiritually speaking, it can apply to us today. And if we ever need a healing in our lands tonight, right now is when we need it. We need hearts to be healed, beloved. We need homes to be healed. My heart is broken over the situation of homes in the world that we live in today. Torn, slap apart of the homes that we're living in today, the animosity that husbands and wives have toward one another. And my heart is absolutely shattered over the fact that people just, man, I tell you, be it neighbors, be it co-workers, be it family members, that they're just at odds with one another. We need a healing in our land. And we can do all the 5-point plans. We can do the 12 steps to this and the 7 steps to that. We can do all that. There's one step, and that's a step of faith in asking Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, placing Him inside of your heart today, being born again from the inside out. That's what's going to make a difference, both in our homes, our neighborhoods, our lands, our marriages, our children. That's what's going to make a difference in Lewis and Badeau and Davis Street. That's what's going to make a difference with this town. That's what's going to make a difference in our villages. That's what's going to make a difference in our lives. And beloved, that's the benefit that we've been given. When God says, greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world. The day that you got saved and born again, the day that you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, wherever it may have been for you, I know where it was for me, you received the Holy Spirit of God inside of you. And that's what spared your soul. That's what gave you life. The Bible says you were once dead in trespasses and sins, but now hath He quickened you. Quickened you. Quickened means to be made alive. The day that happened, you received the one that is greater than all this world has to offer. You've received the one that is greater than every single battle that this world will throw your way. And that's a benefit. Yes, man. Eternal life is a benefit. But beloved, you cannot miss out on the benefits that God has given us here. You know who's going to get you through the battles in this world today? Not the self-help books. Not psychology. Not the counselors. No. Not going to happen. That'll get you through little steps here and there. It's only temporary. That's all that is. What's going to get you through those issues is the one that is greater, the one that gives us the benefit, the one that helps us through the battles, Lastly, beloved brethren, benefit of God's people is we get to have His blessings. Go back to verse 4 with me tonight. The Bible says, "Ye are of God, little children, and overcome them, because greater is He that is in you than he that is in the world." Let me encourage you this tonight, my friend. No matter how dark it may be, no matter how many trials you may be facing, no matter the struggles that you're experiencing, be it physical, spiritual, emotional, mental, whatever it may be, whatever you're facing in your life tonight, don't quit. When times are dark and they seem like your prayers are not answered, don't quit. Stand. When times seem gloomy and your life is in despair, don't quit. Pray. When times seem to get so hard and so rough and so cold and so indifferent, don't quit, but trust in God with all that He has given you and that all that He will do. Yes, this world appears as if they've had a victory, and this world appears as if they've won some battles. And you know what? They may have, but I'm telling you right now, we've won the war. We've won the war. The people of God, we have the God of heaven, the one that created all things for His good pleasure and for His good will and for His glory. We are the children of the living God tonight. We, as born-again believers, are the bride of the Lord Jesus Christ. And because greater is He that is in you than he that is in this world, we have the power tonight to not quit in the life that God has allowed us to have in this world. So, beloved, you say, "Well, preacher, what are you saying now? How are you going to leave this thing up into the Lord's table this evening?" I think it's quite easy. The Bible tells us at the Lord's table, we do show the Lord's death until He comes, right? Had Jesus Christ not died, paid our price for our sins, we wouldn't have He that is in us that is greater than this world. Do you know what we do? If we didn't have the Lord Jesus Christ die for our sins, if we didn't have the ordinance to recognize and remember His sacrifice on the cross of Calvary, if we didn't have that tonight, we couldn't face the battles that is in this world. Man, we couldn't even get through the first world battles that we talked about this morning between cell phones and Vodafone and oh yeah, we couldn't even get through first world problems, much less second or third. So friend, I want to encourage you tonight. This is a message of encouragement. Yes, there's battles. We as the people of God have the benefit of God's blessings. And we can know that He that is inside of us has enabled us to be the victor in every battle that may come our way. So, beloved, whatever you do in this life tonight, don't quit. Father, we thank You, dear Lord, for all that You've done, for who and what You are. We ask You, God, to hear our prayers this evening. We pray that You'd answer them according to Thy will. We do lift up the name of Christ and exalt You on high, that all things, dear God, may be done to Thy glory, to Thy praise. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen and amen. Open your Bible.